गुड इवनिंग मिसेस चैटर्जी, एम आई ऑडिबल? हेलो मैम, कैन यू हियर मी राइट नाउ? मैम, कैन यू अनम्यूट योर माइक्रोफोन?
हेलो। हाँ
हेलो,
हेलो, गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन।
आई रिक्वेस्ट एवरी पार्टिसिपेंट टू प्लीज म्यूट देमसेल्फ। प्लीज म्यूट योर माइक्रोफोन्स एंड डू नॉट शेयर योर स्क्रीन एंड टर्न ऑफ योर वीडियो प्लीज।
Director, you may start.
Welcome everyone to today's session. Today we are having our special lecture series in lecture for our webinar series. We are delighted to have Mrs. Indrani Chatterjee as our speaker for today's talk. She will be discussing on the job retrenchment environment, sustainability, society rebooting in the new normal. Before I hand over to Professor Ednare Banerjee, a couple of announcements for the participants to please mute your microphones and turn off their videos, and please do not share your screen during the session. Now I would request Professor Ednare Banerjee, the convener of this webinar series, to welcome our speaker. Oh, ma'am, over to you.
Thank you, Nandita. Something is the matter with my computer, I think, so I'm not visible, but I hope I'm audible. So yeah. a very warm welcome to everyone, all the participants here and on YouTube and all the future participants. Progress and prospects in biology, although the name is biology, it encompasses multiple disciplines. And today's talk will, in a way, embody the disciplines, the training in those disciplines, and life after. The series, this special lecture series, is meant to be a convergence of ideas. The first lecture was given by Professor Pritha Mukhopadhyay, who discussed the problems of the new normal. How it is both a crisis and an opportunity, and how to go about it, how to readjust and reboot. And I think this word is borrowed from you, Indrani, who I'm delighted to welcome as our speaker tonight. And she started her career in core science and has been an excellent student, but she deviated, and today she is again on top of her game. So Indrani, I will request you to also share your journey to here. Talking about the new normal, there are new ways of looking at things, new opportunities, and this platform, which is exclusively conceived and organized and run by research scholars, would also reflect their angst and their celebrations, which is the career prospects and how to go about it. The enterprise of science and other disciplines probably converge there. And Indrani, I'm so glad that you will be able to probably tell us more about it. So without further ado, Nandita, I hand over to you. I'm sorry, my video is not working. Some malware probably has infected my system, which is again a crisis and an opportunity for some people. So, Nandita, I'll request you to do the honors.
Yes, ma'am. Yes. Mrs. Indrani Chatterjee is an eloquent TEDx speaker and has over 20 years of professional experience in the corporate world. At present, she is working as a group HR advisor for All Cargo Logistics. Mrs. Chatterjee has a rich experience in human resources, industrial relations, CSR, resource management, as well as the brand and corporate communications. She has worked in the leading organizations such as PepsiCo International and Vodafone India. She was the Chief People Officer and Director, Human Capital for PricewaterhouseCoopers. Mrs. Chatterjee has received the MSc degree in organic chemistry and MBA in HR and information system, and also pursued PGCHRM from XLRI Jamshedpur. She holds a professional degree in television news reading and media anchoring. Mrs. Chatterjee has received many professional awards for her contribution to the HR domain. She is the chapter vice president of NHRD Kolkata. Now I would request Mrs. Chatterjee to take over to deliver her talk. So ma'am, over to you.
Thank you, Nandita. Thank you, Professor Banerjee. Extremely happy to be with all of you today. So do I open my video or I'll keep the video off?
Yes, ma'am, you can open it.
Okay, can you see me now?
No, yes, ma'am, you're visible.
I'm visible, okay. But I see some of you are visible, so I would request you to put the video off because there would be bandwidth issues as more and more people join the seminar. So yeah, thank you, Nandita. Thank you for your kind words. Yeah, if I have to sum up my career in one word, as you have rightly read it out, I have done my post-graduation in organic chemistry, shifted to HR, and also did a lot of other things which are remotely not related to HR. One of them is definitely a course in media and news reading. And likewise, there are various other things which I have also pursued. One thing that has remained common and which had actually given me whatever I have achieved in my life is the passion about whatever I do. When I was doing my post-graduation in organic chemistry, I was enjoying it to the core. But the day I realized that I was not enjoying the subject, I shifted to a different domain. I always felt that it's the people which actually gives me energy in school, in college, and subsequently in my corporate world. It's the people, it's the environment, that actually kept me going amongst all the ups and downs of my life that I have encountered in last few years. And yes, when I look back, it has been a fantastic journey. Today we are talking about sustainability. We are also talking about various other things which we have taken for granted for so long. And I know we have a time slot of 1 hour. But I would like to keep this session very, very interactive because otherwise it would seem like a lecture session, which I would not be very comfortable with. So I would request all of you to send your questions in the chat box, and I would like to keep it. Because the topic that I'm going to discuss today, honestly, none of us have any answers to all the questions that are there. Rather, none of us are having any answers to all the questions, all the situations and the crisis, and subsequently all the opportunities that are coming our way in last four months, to be precise. I remember before I get into the topic, I'd like to share one story. In my current organization, as you have rightly introduced myself as the group HR, so our business is spread across the globe, and we are into a business of logistics, which actually is very much into ocean freight. I remember sometime in January, maybe mid-January or end of January, because a major portion of our business comes from China. And we saw that there is a dip in our business, especially in the ocean freight, especially in the cargo that was coming from China. And then we had called a meeting in our organization with few of our people, especially people who are involved in the business of China, that why this is happening. And then we heard that, okay, there's some virus, which is called COVID-19, which has impacted Wuhan, and which is creating some havoc. And hence we need to divert our routes. So we are into, as I said, into ocean freight. So we actually send cargo from one country to another to simplify our line of business. So we said, okay, fine, if China is not working, then let's route it through any other Southeastern countries or any other ports. Maybe we can divert our cargo. If China is a problem area, then we can divert it through Europe, or we can navigate through Africa, America, but at the end of the day, it's a Huan problem. And what is Huan? Maybe some of us, for the first time, we heard that there is a city called Huan, which is the industrial town of China. And we said, okay, fine, it's a neighbor's problem. It's not going to hit us. Fine. We created a BCP plan. We created a route planning. And we also tried to navigate the ways. If you remember, around end of January, that's the New Year time for the Chinese New Year. Of course, the traffic is very high because people exchange gifts all across the world, and it's a peak season for us. So of course we were very concerned that the China traffic is down, but little did we realize that 2 months down the line, none of the reroute planning, none of the business continuity plan will work. And this Huan, or this COVID-19, or this coronavirus, whatever we term it, is going to create such kind of havoc in each and every element on this planet that we are forced to rethink, reboot, and reset. Today, my discussion will be focused on these three elements. Of course, I'll talk on planet, I'll talk on profit. And if I'm talking on planet and profit, how can I not involve the element which is most impacted, and that is the people. So very, very good evening, all of you who is here on a weekend in front of your laptop to listen to me. I'm sure this is going to be a very, very interesting session. I am Indrani, and I cannot claim that I am an expert in the subject, but I can only claim that I will share my experience that I have faced in last 4 months or 4.5 months, little more than that, and how we are trying to navigate the situation that has been thrown to us. It's not perfect. Nothing is perfect. That is something that we have realized. But definitely, we are trying to get the best out of this situation. Just like Professor Banerjee said, that it's a crisis, and it is up to us how we can convert this crisis into opportunity. So if I go to the next slide, these are the things that I would be discussing. I would also like to highlight on pressing the reset button to the new normal. Yes, everything that we are doing is extremely new and something we have never done before. We have never addressed a crowd like this on a Saturday evening through a laptop. In a normal situation today, either we would be going out for a dinner or we will be shopping at the South City Mall or any other mall. But today we are listening to this seminar and through a digital platform. And of course, the last but not the least, I would like to highlight on a particular topic which I actually came across and which touched my heart, and it is decoding luxury. So yeah, if I start with the first point, which is the planet. If you can go to the next slide. This is a group who is absolutely into the core of the virus, and I do not need to explain the composition of the virus. But what I can explain to all of you is this virus has created an impact which is definitely going to stay with us for the centuries to come. This virus has not only touched the healthcare or the health aspect of the human beings, but it has touched every possible dimensions, the basic core of the society and the basic core of the sustenance of the human existence. So this is omnipresent now. Everywhere that we look around, this virus is dictating us. If I may sum it up, this virus is dictating us, our thought process, the way we are responding, the way we are looking at things, the way we are interacting with our fellow people, with our family, friends, colleagues, the way we are behaving. Everything is now being dictated by a virus, and we do not know a perfect solution for that. But does that mean that the human existence will cease? Definitely not. We have faced this kind of crisis before. I am not very sure of this magnitude, but of course of equal magnitude. And definitely we will try to find out ways to navigate this as well. What this virus did to us is definitely it exposed the basic vulnerability of the society and of our existence. We cannot deny the fact that we all are extremely vulnerable today in front of this small virus, which has taken control of our lives. What we can do, and are we responsible? Because I know there are talks, whether it's a man-made or whether it is natural, and I'm not going to get into that. I'm not an expert. All of you are much more educated, much more knowledgeable on this matter. But from where I see things, I don't know whether it is man-made. I don't know whether it is generated by somebody taking, consuming that. I really don't know, and I don't want to get there. But what I really know is, today, the situation that we are into, definitely we are responsible. We, as human beings, we have exploited to the extreme level this planet Earth, which is something which we should not have done. If it is, whether it is global warming or whether it is any kind of forest fires, whether it's earthquake, whether it is cyclone, simple thing, we faced an Amphan and we were completely locked and we were completely tied to our rooms. Everything that we are facing, I'm sure it's a consequence of the exploitation that the human race has been doing over centuries. And today, sooner or later, we had to pay the price, and unfortunately, we are paying the price. But fortunate enough that I'm hopeful that we will leave a better world for our next generation. If we are paying the price for everything that we have done, I'm sure our next generation would have a better life, and that is what I am very hopeful for. I would like to also talk about a little bit on the corporate social responsibility in a moment, and what does it mean, and of course the role of the corporates and the role of everyone in the society around the corporate social responsibility. Because when we talk about exploitation, when we agree and acknowledge and accept the fact that yes, we have ruined the Mother Earth, I think there is an opportunity that has been given to us to undo everything that we have done. Few years back, and if I remember, it was somewhere around 2013, 2014, where the government had made it mandatory to actually allocate around 2% of the profit of each corporate on the corporate social responsibility. And what does that mean? That it means that every corporate is having a profit, has to contribute a portion of its profit for the cause of the society. And likewise, every corporate which is into existence and having profit is contributing to the society. But some of us were doing it more religiously, more diligently, and was doing it with lot of heart and dedication. So when we talk about the corporate social responsibility, we think about giving money to the NGOs, and NGOs will take care. But that doesn't actually ensure the responsibility that we need to take to actually serve our society. So what we used to do in our organization is to seek nomination for the volunteers who would volunteer for all the corporate social responsibility. So for example, if we are going to a school and giving some money in form of donation for buying books or building a school building, there were volunteers who had actually gone and painted the school building. There were actually volunteers who had gone and cleaned the washrooms. I can give one example. In our organization, a few months back, we went for a Juhu Beach drive. We could have given the money to the NGOs, and they would have jolly well done that through their volunteers. But our employees actually took the responsibility of cleaning up the Juhu Beach. And that was a huge, huge, I would say, life-changing experience for all our employees, who actually realized that there's a huge amount of pleasure in cleaning the Mother Earth. There are a lot of examples which I can give around corporate social responsibility, which all the organizations are taking. But I think today, everyone across the globe, in every strata of the society, should take up this responsibility, whether the corporate is taking the responsibility on its shoulder or not, whether it is sharing its profit with the NGOs, it doesn't matter. But I think as a responsible corporate citizen, as a responsible citizen, we need to take this responsibility, do things on our own, irrespective of the fact whether the government has given that mandate of Swachh Bharat. I think keeping our society clean, keeping our neighborhood clean is something that is a very, very basic thing that we all need to do. Because if we don't do this, this pandemic is not going to end with COVID-19. And I'm very scared, you know why? Because it seems that after COVID-19, will there be a COVID-20? Why this series of 19? And that's just my thought. I'm not here to scare you. But what is, if it's high time that we take responsibility to clean up the society, to clean up our mindset, and not to wait for the sweepers and the municipality workers to clean up the community, to clean up the streets in the morning, and we litter, we keep on littering everything that we were doing. It's time that we clean up everything, starting from our mind, clean up our thoughts, and clean up our society, so that we are next time prepared to face this kind of pandemic. Because from where we see things, this is not going to be a one-off situation. This is going to come in series, maybe in different magnitude, but definitely it is going to come. If we go to the next slide. Yeah, so this is a slide which I would like to discuss a little bit in details, because this is talking about, and this is not something fictional. If you see, these are the points that I have directly lifted from some of the leading newspapers as recent as yesterday and day before yesterday. The New York Times, dated 31st of July 2020, the headlines as of yesterday is "Virus Wipes Out 5 Years Economic Growth." And the economic cost attached to it is 9.5% dip in the GDP, which is huge, by the way. The Financial Express, which was published on 30th July, did not give any different story. And the headlines were like, "Indigo Post worst quarterly loss in 5 years, Maruti post first loss ever, TVS Motor reports loss of 139 crores, SpiceJet reports 807 crore loss for March quarter, Dr. Reddy's net dips 13%, Raymond cuts jobs." So since I am from the corporate world and I am into HR, and my hands are deep into this execution, I can very well say with a lot of conviction, in last 4-5 months, the economy has gone from bad to worse and is heading towards a devastating disaster. I do not want to scare anyone, but I would definitely want all of you to know that this is the reality. If I look around and I see every day, every single day, that some company is either laying off, going for job retrenchment, going for closure, salary cuts, freeze on increment, bonuses, and with that, the entire setup, the social setup, the economical setup is having a big question mark around when this is going to revive, and no one has the answer. Our Prime Minister initially had said, if you remember, on 24th of March, if I remember the date exactly, 24th or 23rd of March, he said that Jaan hai to jahan hai, and then he moved to Jaan bhi jahan bhi, which means that the economical health is as important as the physical health. And today we are in a situation which is very, very grim, because every day with all the job losses and the job cuts that is happening, it is creating a huge financial pressure on the system. It is creating huge financial pressure on the society, because this is having a ripple effect in every household. We have become very conscious. We are cutting back on our spends. We have become very, very conscious about everything that we are doing. We are trying to save every penny that we have, which is good in a way. We are trying to save every penny that we have. But at the same time, because the consumers are not spending, it is also having an impact on the economy. And that is why you see that all the organizations who have actually recorded their statements have recorded losses in last quarter and the quarter before. And it was said that if India is going through two quarters of recession, then it is definitely heading towards depression. And I think this quarter or the quarter after, India will head towards depression, because globally, the depression is already touching a few countries. And I'll see it in the next slide. Yes. So if I just only focus on US, because that's the biggest economy that we have, it has been actually recorded that the COVID-19 pandemic toll on the global economy became emphatically clear when most of the government across the globe detailed the most devastating 3-month collapse on record. And every country, whether it is US or whether it any country in Europe, whether it's India, none of them have recorded any positive information on the GDP or on the situation of the economic status of the country, which is worrisome, because we now really don't know where to go and where to bank upon. The consumer, as I mentioned, the consumers have cut back on the spending, businesses have pared the investments, and global trade have dried up. There was a huge furor on banning the Chinese goods. But I'm not very sure that whether that's going to help the economy. But that's a sentimental aspect, and I'm not going to discuss it here. But I think the global trade have dried up, which had created a chaos and havoc in the economical situation globally. And there are mounting evidences that the economy is slowly freezing. So what does it mean? It means that, does it mean that we are heading towards doomsday? No, I think there are, when we face with this kind of crisis, from this crisis, there are a lot of opportunities that crops up. And today I am addressing a group of people who are into biology, who are into life sciences, and who are absolutely in a situation who would be majorly benefited from this whole situation. And I'll come in a moment why I think so. But before that, I think the entire economic situation that we are currently into, it is definitely not good, but the need of the hour is to demonstrate resilience. Need of the hour is to demonstrate that yes, we are capable of overcoming this obstacle as well. And once we overcome this, we will be much more stronger, and we would be in a position to become much more resilient workforce, whether it is in the pharma, whether it is in the IT segment, whether it is in the technology segment, logistics segment, any segment, but we will have a much better and much more resilient workforce. In the Western world, people are, I would say, much more privileged than us, because they get employment benefits. In India, we are not yet benefit in that manner, because once we lose our jobs, we do not get that kind of employment benefit, which puts our situation in a really tricky platform. But I strongly believe we Indians have an immense capacity of bouncing back every time we are being faced with any kind of hardship and any kind of crisis. And I'm absolutely hopeful this time also India will emerge as the winner in the face of this amount of adversity. Because today we feel, and this is actually proven, that the Indians have the highest level of adversity quotient that is required to handle any kind of adversity. And hence, it is definitely amongst all the crises, amongst all the gloom stories that we are reading every day, there lies a huge opportunity for the Indians to come out because of our resilience, because of our capability to actually absorb adversity. And that's why there is a huge wave of Make in India, whereby people are talking that the manufacturing setup can come to India, whereby there would be a huge opportunity, whereby employment and the overall economy in the long run will benefit. Just an anecdote that is there, in USA, around 30 million people are now getting unemployment benefit, which itself talks that the amount of people who have lost the jobs, have been given furlough, or have been laid off, and have applied for unemployment benefit. This is the data that is available. Likewise, in Europe also, especially in Germany and in UK, there are huge amount of unemployment registrations that has happened because they are also seeking the unemployment benefits in India as well. But we don't have that data. But just for the sake of information, only in US there is a 30 million people who are now getting unemployment, and this has happened in last 4 months. So you can imagine the amount of impact this virus has on the economy and on the profit. Can we go to the next slide? So if I have already touched on the jobs, and it's a global phenomena. It is not like Indians are losing jobs everywhere. Every segment, it's losing job. Yet amongst everything, like Phoenix Rises, there are segments which are being benefited, and the segment which gets the most benefit out of this situation is the pharma. Of course, that's the light at the end of the tunnel. The research scientist, huge opportunity for everyone in this audience today to actually encash this situation. I also feel the technology and the automation sector is going to see a huge boom, because now we are moving into a segment where it would be more automated, things will get more digitalized, things will be done more remotely. Something which we never thought before, because this is something that we have always challenged, that there are segments which cannot work from home, but today we have learned that every segment can actually work from home. Will it be a continuous effort? No. I think the corporate world will get into a hybrid workforce, whereby 30% or 40% of the workforce will continue to work remotely, and the rest, 60%, will have a combination of working remotely and going to office. Having said that, this will also have a very, very good impact on every aspect. It will reduce the carbon footprint, because there will be less travel, there will be less pollution, you will get more time to spend with the family, you will get more time to do things that you wanted to do in life, because you will spend less time in traveling. So definitely, when we talk about opportunity is always followed by a crisis, these are the things that are expected out of this situation. And hybrid workforce, whether it is in the academic sector or whether it is in the corporate sector, we definitely foresee that 100% of the population is never going to go back to the work, physical offices. Work will continue, the world will continue to work, the world cannot stop working, but the mode of work will now get changed permanently. As we move into the technology and as we move into more digital platforms, I think one thing that is very, very important, and especially for all of you, because you will be dealing with a lot of information, a lot of confidential data, I think one thing that is definitely going to be extremely important from a knowledge point of view and from a change perspective is to protect the data and the work that you are doing. Because if everything is on the platform which can be accessed remotely, a huge question on the data security comes into play, and that is where the IT segment and the technology platform needs to be tightened with lots and lots of firewalls and lots of locks and keys, whereby the data is not divulged, data is not hacked, because at the end of the day, the data is something that is extremely, extremely rare and valuable, and we need to preserve it. So the data security is something that needs to be maintained as we move, as we strive for more digitization. That's an area that we need to look into. And then if we are working remotely, if we are getting things delivered, I'm sure in last 3-4 months you have experienced the magic of getting things delivered at the doorstep. Of course, if you are getting everything delivered into doorstep, the segment that is going to flourish is the e-commerce. So yes, these are the segments which will definitely benefit: the pharma, the technology, the automation, the e-commerce, the digital segment. All of them is definitely going to see a huge boom in the coming months. So if any of you are thinking of pursuing your career in this line, I think this is the right time to think to navigate and shift your career, especially because you are into biology, especially if you are into life sciences. Pharma is actually looking extremely bright and it's going to shine up. So I think it's a very, very good news for all of you to pursue this line. Next 5 to 10 years or beyond that, pharma is going to touch its peak. Next slide, people. Yeah. So if I talk about planet and if I talk about profit, the person, for lack of better word, the element which is getting most impacted by the planet and the profit is people. Now, and at the end of the day, we are where we are because of what we have done, because of what we are doing, and because of what we will be doing. So what we will be doing now, I think we should think that we cannot now keep on thinking why this has happened. We have to see, we have to realize this has happened and now what we can do. I think the topmost thing that comes to our mind and everyone's mind is health and safety. Today, when we are thinking of bringing our workforce to the physical office, the first thing as HR professionals, first thing as corporate leaders that we are thinking is how do we make our workplace safe, secured, and give an environment, completely sanitized environment, so that nobody falls prey to this virus. So health and safety is on the topmost priority list, as it is as much as it was never before in everybody's mind. Of course, with the economic degrowth, as I have mentioned before, there are impact on the people, on the society, on the human civilization, because it is not only about the monetary aspect, it has also to do with lot of other aspects. And here I cannot ignore the fact that the impact it has on the mental health, the insecurity that it brings with the loss of job, loss of financial security, which is tremendous. So I cannot ignore the fact that a huge amount of insecurity is looming large. And why only on the corporate people? Why only on the society? I cannot ignore the fact that this is the amount of insecurity it is having among the students, especially the students who are in their final year of graduation or post-graduation. We have seen what had happened, the amount of insecurity that the students of class 12 and class 10 have gone through because they couldn't complete their board exams. So the students who are absolutely stepping into a different world, who would be very, very excited of stepping into a world where they would be taking up jobs or taking up research assignments or taking up any other entrepreneurial activity. Today, they are very, very insecure and uncertain about their future. So, of course, they are insecure. Today, I cannot think of a single profession who is not working round the clock. And the first profession which comes to my mind is doctors. They are not prepared to go to work their workplace in that kind of PPEs. I can't even imagine how they are doing it day in, day out for so many months. So I have a high regard for all my colleagues, friends, and everyone who is into this profession, the healthcare workers. They are putting their lives at risk. It's very unfortunate that every day we are reading in the newspaper about the doctors who are losing lives. I remember other day somebody said that, why are you so getting so impacted? Are we not losing our army men to the war? But my logic was, yes, we are, but they do sign up. They know that is a part of their job. Doctors, when they completed their MBA or MBBS, when they did their MDs, or when they chose this profession, they never knew that every day, every single day, they would have to go to a workplace which is not less than the battleground. And imagine the insecurity that is there back at their home with having aging parents, pregnant wives, young children. So I think I have huge amount of regards for and respect for this profession now. Scientists, every day they are struggling to find out a solution. Economists, they are trying to navigate how do we come out of the situation. Corporate leaders, of course, all of us, we are trying to find out a perfect solution, how not to retrench people, how not to lay off people. Trust me, it is equally painful to ask somebody to go, because we also know that that they are the breadwinner earners, their family is dependent on us, and it also has a huge amount of impact on a professional like us to say that from tomorrow you are not required because the business is not doing well. So I think if I can tell one thing, that all of us are together into it, because I can't think of anybody who is not into it, who is not impacted. And if something as big as this pandemic has happened where everyone is into it together, I think as a group we have to come out of it together. So we have been talking about social distancing, but I think it is more appropriate to mention it is more about physical distancing. I think we have realized the value of getting connected socially. We have tried to hold on to each other socially, whether through Zoom calls or whether through phone calls, various video calls, taking care of each other remotely, asking about the well-being of our family, friends. We are doing it more often because what we have realized is the life is extremely valuable. So I think that we have not distanced socially, we have connected socially more, but we have maintained a physical distance for the sake of everyone and for sake of ourselves. I have mentioned about mental issues. I have spoken about the insecurity that is there. Yes, everyone in our own way is feeling very lonely because we are not used to this kind of isolation, and it is important that we all try to realize that everyone is fighting their own battle, and a little bit of patience from each other will actually help all of us to tide over this crisis. One thing which I had read a long back, maybe in school, I had a very very big inclination towards quotations at that time. And suddenly the other day I remembered this quotation, and that fishermen repairs the net when they can't go to the sea for fishing. And I felt that today this is the most appropriate situation that we are into. We can't do whatever we want to do, and hence it is the right time for us to upgrade ourselves, to upgrade our nets, because tomorrow when we are again out in the market, we should be equipped with some skills. It's the right time. You are saving so much of time in travel, you are saving so much of time by working from home. Why not take up a new skill? Why not take up a new hobby? Why not upgrade your skill so that when you are actually addressing the corporate world or stepping into the corporate world tomorrow, once everything is over, you are actually having one more additional skill, which in a normal situation, because of the busyness that you would be so engrossed with, you would not have got the opportunity. So yes, you see, there's one more opportunity that can come out of this crisis. Utilize this time to upgrade yourself, learn a new skill, go for some training, something which you have not done, maybe always thought, it's always at your back of the mind that someday I'll do it. If I retire, then I'll do it. Do it now. Now is the time, because tomorrow you might not get the time. And interesting thing, today we are all using this, that negative is the new positive. We are happy if we are found negative. We are not very happy if we are found positive. So on that lighter note, I would request you to go to the next slide. So I know I'm a little conscious of time, so I'll just rush through this slide. How do I reset the button? It is just like we are using a laptop, we are using a mobile phone, and it got corrupted. If I say that it got a virus had got into our laptop, we have to reset the whole thing. We have to format the whole thing. We are actually resetting and formatting our life's gadget, because a virus has got into our system. Like every gadget, if a virus is getting into the system, we try to press the reset button and get into a factory setting. I think the society is rebooting itself to the factory setting and cleaning itself up. So, and we are slowly shifting our mindset. Last 4 months, 5 months have taught us that let's get back to our basics. The luxury lies in the basics. It's a paradigm shift. And when I talk about paradigm shift, it's a shift of the mindset that is required. That yes, life is important. Life is important. The most important thing that we have is the life, and lives needs to be protected before the economy is open. And hence we have to be very, very sure of what we are doing. I think another thing that we have realized in last few months is how do we value what we have. I was discussing with a very close friend of mine that today we are using the last bit of the vegetable that we are having in the kitchen, not because we can't buy, just because we want to save it. And hence valuing the little pleasures of life is something that this virus has taught us. Not taking things for granted. I think for too long we have taken things for granted, be it relationship, be it our lives, be it the money that we have in the bank, be it the environment, be it the luxuries that came our way. Everything we thought is unending, and we are always blessed with so many things. So we had the problem of plenty. We never thought of a situation where we would not get anything. And when we look around today, we feel that we had taken so many things for granted. Maybe we are paying the price for that. I think hence we need to shift our mindset, get back to basics, become more self-reliant. One thing that we have realized, and I'm sure everyone, especially in India, we have realized the importance of maids, that the importance of the maids that we have in our household. The day we stopped them from entering our households, we understood the pain of cleaning our own utensils. We understood the pain of making our own bed, and we understood how important they were. And then we realized that all these years we were so much reliant on them that we were far away from being self-reliant. I think the time has come to become more self-reliant so that we do not remain mentally paralyzed. The day we realized that we are not going to get the services from our maid servants, we thought that, oh my God, the world is crashing in front of us. But today, most of us are now used to doing things on our own. And hence, I think this virus is again rebooting and resetting us to the new normal of becoming more self-reliant. Something maybe many decades back, our ancestors have done that, and we are again doing it. Courage over comfort. I think we were very comfortable with certain luxuries of life, and now we need to take the courage. We have to gather the courage to do things which we have not done before. And hence I say that courage over comfort is something that we need to do. Cleaner environment given. I think I don't need to elaborate on that. And more focus on physical and mental health. Yes, we are going to be more focused on physical health, but we cannot deny the fact that mental health is equally important. And we need to realize that mental health can create havoc in our lives if we do not realize and accept that that's also a disease that needs to be taken care of. So these are the things I think we need to, as I said, that we need to reboot ourselves, we need to reset ourselves, and we have to format our system, format the society to the factory setting. I think these are the things, when we press the reset button, these are the things that we need to keep in mind. Can we go to the next slide? Yeah, so this is a thought that this is an article which crossed which I read a few days back, and it actually had a very, very long lasting impact on my mind. And I'm not going to read the entire thing here. You can read it on your screens, but it is just like, we thought luxury is something that is beyond our reach. We always thought luxury is having a high-end car. Luxury is going to foreign location. Luxury is enjoying a sumptuous dinner in a five-star hotel. That's what luxury was defined in our dictionary. These 4 months have actually made us realize that luxury is as simple as allowing yourself to meet your family and friends, allowing yourself to breathe outside normally without a mask. We thought that air is given. We are entitled for air. But even today, the air is a luxury for us, because people who are going out, people who are actually going to work or actually following on the protocols, they are telling how suffocating it is to work. Other day, I saw a friend of mine who is going to work. He is having a face shield. He is having a shower cap. He is having a face mask, and it left an impact on my mind that my God, if a person is working like this, it is so suffocating. And how can a person work with that kind of protection? The doctors are performing surgeries with PPEs. My friends are sending pictures that they are all drenched. This is a luxury to actually allowing ourselves to breathe in the fresh air without the mask. And luxury is also to walk on the seashore. Luxury is also to have a coffee with your friend. Luxury is also not to step into a hospital and not to get that ventilator, which we are also scared of. So this is luxury. Luxury is not something that is waiting for us during the summer vacation for a Europe trip. This is luxury, and we need to decode it before it is too late, friends. The last slide before I take questions is, luxury is the smiles that we are so used to from our friends, the hug that we were actually getting from our friends. Luxury is not to click the sunset, the sunrise picture from your bedroom, not the picture of the sky from the bedroom and post it on the Facebook. Luxury is actually the fact that we can go out and enjoy the sunrise and the sunset. And the biggest luxury that today we are having is the privilege of getting loved and the fact that we are still alive. That is the luxury. I think all this is luxury. That is something that we did not know. Thank you very much. I have taken more time. I think that's a luxury, but I am open for any questions. Thank you very much for listening to me patiently.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am, for such a motivational talk. I would like to take some questions. So the first question is, economical health is more important to many people, because if they don't go out risking their life, they might die of starvation. What are your views on it?
Absolutely. That's why I said that Jaan bhi, Jahan bhi. It is extremely important, and that if you are not stepping out, if you are not going for jobs, the amount of insecurity that is there, it will create a havoc in the families. So it is important. At the same time, it is important that we follow all the protocols. I cannot say please do not go for work, but I will say that please follow all the protocols, maintain the distance, social distancing, wear masks, wash your hands, sanitize the place that you are working, sanitize your hands, everything, but protect yourself so that you can protect everybody that is back at home. And you have to go out for work. You cannot keep yourself caged in your house. You have to step out, you have to earn the bread. At the same time, you have to protect. So that's a balance that you have to maintain between how you protect your health and how you protect your job. I cannot say that don't work. I'm also working. Everyone around us is working, but you have to manage the protocols, wearing the mask, wearing sanitizing, cleaning, maintaining social distancing. When you come back home, you have to maintain all the protocols, taking bath, etc., so that you are protected. But you have to continue with your job.
Thank you, ma'am. The next question is, entrepreneurship in which fields will be favorable post-COVID?
So many, I would say. I think first one is, as I mentioned, e-commerce. E-commerce is a very easy entrepreneurial department. I think that's an area that everyone is going, shifting. So I think that's one area that is going to see the biggest boom. Second is technology. All of you who are the millennials today, I'm sure everyone is millennial. I think the technology, the digital platforms, this is another area where you definitely need to focus if you are thinking of setting up something on your own. Entrepreneurs would do very well in the technological department, in the digital department, in the e-commerce, pharma, I'm not very sure because pharma is very technical. But yes, any kind of remote services through pharma, doctor on call. There are so much of apps today. Everybody is actually servicing through apps. So I think that's something that everyone who is thinking of becoming an entrepreneur can think on. But I think the biggest one is technology and e-commerce.
Okay, ma'am. So the next question is, the job privilege in India is not as good as foreign country because of its huge population. So how we can cope up with that?
The job situation of India is not as good as, I would say, I don't know who has sent this question, but thank you for sending this question. I would say, I would like to differ a little bit on this, because the job in India, we still have jobs in the Western world. Much before COVID happened, the economic situation was crashing, and the jobs were not available. So still jobs were available in India, and it is still in India only where you see jobs are available. How do you cope? I think India is a fantastic country. I think the opportunities that you get in India is second to none, because in India, I would say both the things. One is the entrepreneurs, as I mentioned, that there's a huge opportunity for the entrepreneurs, for the students, for the people who are stepping into the corporate world to actually pursue their dream of becoming entrepreneur in this technology or in the e-commerce platform. At the same time, for the jobs as well, because jobs get outsourced to India, there are still options for all of us to get jobs in India. So hold on to it, get into the right connection, do the right networking, you will still get the job in India. Yeah, situation of the Western world, especially in US and in UK, I would say situation is much, much grim than what we see in India. So don't lose hope, jobs are still there in India. And going forward, as I mentioned, there will be a shift where more and more things will shift to India.
Okay, ma'am. So the next question is, the negative is the new positive. What does it mean in terms of economy?
Okay, fantastic question. Negative is new positive. I have mentioned that in terms of COVID, like if you are COVID negative, then it is it's a good news. In the domain of economic situation, it is not a good sign. Economy has to be in a positive platform. It cannot be in the negative platform. Today we are going down. It is in the negative platform. So we have to shift the gear to the positive platform. And as I said, the data that I shared with all of you, the data of last 2 days newspaper, it is negative, but sooner than later, we will shift the gear towards more positive. It cannot continue. We are hitting the rock bottom. It can only go up from there. So economy has to be on the positive. It cannot be in the negative. COVID has to be in the negative to have the economy on the positive.
Yes, ma'am. So the next question is, to step in a corporate life, what are those skills need to learn during this time? Like how we will prepare for the corporate world during this situation?
You know what? This is so interesting. Corporate world is a world which is full of uncertainty. Corporate world is a world where every day you will be thrown with new challenges and you would not be having answers to it. You have to find out answers through a lot of trial and error method. Corporate world is also a world where you have to be very careful about what is coming. I think all of these things, if I relate to the COVID situation today, we are facing this. So if after COVID is over, if we step into the corporate world, we should step into the corporate world with all the learnings that we have gained during the COVID situation. For example, managing a crisis. If we are faced with a crisis, we have to find out an opportunity. If we do not know an answer, we have to reach out to people to get the answer. Honestly, if you ask me today, even after so many years of experience, all the corporate leaders, we do not know the answers to so many questions that are being thrown at us. But only thing that is being useful for all of us is being extremely honest and upfront and say, hey, look, I don't have the answer. Let's try to solve the situation together. I think that is something when you step into the corporate world, keep yourself very open to all the situation that you come by. Be very resilient. Do not lose hope. I have seen fantastic students from premier institutes with very, very good marks stepping into the corporate world and succumbing to the corporate world's pressure because they cannot handle the politics. They cannot handle the pressure. They cannot handle today on a different platform in a different world. We are talking about nepotism. But nepotism is everywhere. Nepotism is there in the corporate world as well. So it is not something new that you are nepotism is only for a particular segment of the society. Nepotism is there in every aspect of your world. So when you step into corporate world, you have to be very, very alerted that these are the things that is going to come your way. You know what? Things become easier when you accept. When you think that, yes, this is going to come and I have to fight it out. When you do not accept, then it becomes difficult. So my suggestion to everyone who is going to step into the corporate world is keep yourself open, accept the crisis and learn. This is the time that you learn, upskill yourself so that you are always ahead of your competitor. So that this is also a fantastic opportunity that has been provided to you. So when you are stepping into the corporate world, you are also honing up a new skill. So these are the things that you need to do.
Thank you, ma'am. So the last question is, set normals to new normals. How kids are going to adjust themselves in the homebound environment?
Kids.
Yeah.
I think the kids are, and I have a daughter, she is a teenager. I have found her much more resilient, much more accepting of the new normal than I am. I think kids have an amazing capacity to absorb anything new. Their resilience power is much higher. Yes, I feel very sad for them. They cannot go to school. They have a whole new world of friends there. They cannot connect with their friends. They cannot go down and play in the park. They are completely caged in the house, which is not right. But I think few things that are very important to keep the kids involved and engaged is, one, they need to pursue the hobbies that can be conducted from home, like painting, like if they are fond of some creative art, they are fond of songs, dancing, maybe yoga, meditation. I think this is something that is very, very important, especially for the young kids, the teenagers. Somewhere I was reading that if every teenager is practicing meditation, world would be a better place. I think that is going to be a very, very key for the kids today. If every kid is actually practicing meditation, they will be in a much, much better position to accept the new normal because their minds will be clear. They will be free of stress because we like it or not, we accept it or not. Teenagers and the young kids also have their own set of stress, own set of frustration. Doing yoga at home, doing meditation at home, focusing and channelizing their energy through art, various other activities like song, dance, debate, elocution, quiz, etc. All of those that can be conducted from home through the technological platform, if they are practicing that, I think they will hone up a lot of other social skills which they would have done if they were given a free environment before COVID. I think for the kids, these are the things that are very, very important. Now that kids have access to a lot more mobile, not a lot more internet, we need to be very conscious that they are using the internet in a productive manner, in a positive manner, and they are practicing all the things that I just mentioned. I think meditation and yoga is also going to be very key to de-stress themselves and put their mental sanity in proper balance.
Thanks a lot, ma'am. We have attended almost all the questions. So now we have come to the end of the session. Thanks a lot for being here. Now I would request Professor Rainare Banerjee to address vote of thanks. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you so much. Indrani, this is the first time I'm seeing you in action, and no wonder you are at the top of your game. And I'm a very, very proud elder sister today. For the others, Indrani was my junior in school, and I know her from a very, very young age. But today, it's a completely different Indrani I see. And the talk was simply wonderful. So the take-home message is that yes, we are COVID negative, all of us today who are attending the lecture, and that is the new positive. Absolutely, we count our blessings, we consolidate on our skills, and we pick up new skills. It's been wonderful. So thank you very much, everyone. Thank you so much, Indrani. It was wonderful to listen to you.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Anadi. Thank you. Goodbye. I wish I could have seen all of you. Someday later, maybe I would go to your campus and address all of you physically and seeing all the lovely faces. Today, I'm only seeing photographs. So
absolutely, that's a date. And you know, I've been trying to switch on my video, but it won't work. I think some malware has taken over. So so that's there. That's a promise. We have to meet physically at some point in time. Hope that will happen. Fingers crossed on that.
Thank you so much. All the best. Stay safe. Stay safe, everyone. Bye.